on?
Listen, that's better than some things I've seen this guy.
Oh, I know. I've seen it. I've witnessed.
Care of the Sanagasa family. It is written in Italian,
rhyming couplets. It's a little more difficult to understand. It is also, as I said before, in the same structure as the Getty. Next one is the Paris, which is written in Latin and is also really pretty because it's in full color. That's about it for Fiore's life.
Okay. Let us back up very briefly and please give us the mission statement of EHMA.
Yes. The mission statement of EHMA is to resurrect, research, study, and practice, and instruct in the combat skills, principles, and philosophies of an accomplished medieval martial artist, to achieve a state which is consistent to skilled medieval martial artist in both technology and ideal.
Great. Now, back to Fiore. So, is there anything else you'd like to tell us about Fiore the man or his works?
No.
Okay. Who's the other guy that you mentioned?
George Silver.
Tell us about him, his life.
Okay. George Silver was a English person of the late 16th century. He really didn't like the Italians because during his time, the popular form of Italian rapier that came in, he didn't like it because he said that it focused more on offense and speed at the cost of their defense, leading to many of his fellow countrymen dying pointlessly. In response, he wrote two books, The Paradox of Defense, and later his brief instructions, My Brief Instructions on My Paradox of Defense, which he did publish. He wrote fairly soon after his first book, but was only published later in the 19th century. In these books, he talks about the principles of fights, things like, is it better to have a longer reach? Is it better to have a spear than a sword, and things like that, as well as fundamental concepts like timing, measure, and how to stay safe in the fight.
Great, and there are some critical concepts that EHMA finds value in your story's descriptions of. What are they?
So the four major things that we take away from George Silver are the principle of the true fight, which is to strike without being struck. Next one, to achieve this, we use true time, which is essentially presenting a threat before a target. He describes it as time of the hand, time of the hand body, time of the hand body foot, time of the hand body feet. There's also false time, which is anything that is not true time. So if I step in with my feet, then body, and then do a punch, that's false time compared to if I lead with my hand, then body, foot. That is an example of true time, presenting a threat before the target. Next, we have the grounds and governors. Grounds are what we use to understand fight. There's judgment, distance, time, and space. Those are the four aspects of grounds. Judgment is knowledge of the art, meaning knowledge of the art. And you use that knowledge to gain the distance which you should stay at. And when you're presented with the time to strike without being struck, you strike into a place, which is a target. Next, we have the governors, which are more of the which is more of the detailed stuff that you use within a fight. So the grounds are kind of like big ideas, and it governs what you use during a fight, that specific fight. It also starts with judgment, which is all the grounds, and plus things like, is your opponent taller than you, bigger than you, stronger than you? Are they sitting in any recognizable guards? Things like that, which you use to find your measure, your control of time and space around you. And when there's an opportunity to defend it to last two are a part of the twofold mind, where no matter how tempting a target is, as you go in and press in and go for that target, if you see a threat coming, you have to deal with that. You have to fly out, because striking is good, but being in is really not good.
Okay. Was there anything else you'd like to tell us about George Silver or his works? Okay, there's an image on this banner here we put up every day, and this is a question for you, please.
Why do we study both Fiore and Liberi and George Silver?
So Fiore and Liberi gives us a really good example of how the martial arts are taught, but it doesn't really explain in particular why in certain places work. We get examples of what we can do, but not necessarily the reasoning as to why we should. George Silver helps us understand why these actions are good and safe, as well as to fill in any gaps between the plays so that we can have good interpretation of what the audience is telling.
Good.
Okay.
There's an image here on the banner. It is in before the manuscript. What is it?
That is the same page. In the middle there, we got a guy, could be Fiore, could be us, could be our opponent. And surrounding him are the seven swords, representing the seven strikes. From the top, going diagonally down, is the pendente. Across the middle, horizontally, we got the mezzani, the horizontal cuts. And we got from the bottom, coming up diagonally, on that same line as the pendente, we got the sultani strikes. Everything on the right side is the mandrio strikes, and everything on the left side is the reversing strikes, forehand and backhand. And the sword coming up directly from the bottom represents punta, the thrust, that can be aimed anywhere at the center line. Next, we got the four animals around. Starting from the top, we got Prudentia, represented by the wings holding a caliber. This represents prudence, knowledge, judgment. Next to it on the left is Hilaritas, which is supposed to be a tiger, holding a arrow representing speed and cunning. Next, we got at the bottom there an elephant with a castle on its back, representing fortitude, strength and stability, structure. And last but not least, we got Adatia on the right side, with the lion in the heart, which represents audacity and courage. Out of these four, Fiore says Adatia is the most important, because even if you have all the advantages of the opponent, if you don't have courage, you won't be able to do anything.
Okay. Any last questions, Kevin? In the theory portion of the test, or thus far? No? All right. Let's move on to the grappling portion. I'll have Bastien, I think. While Bastien is coming in, please give us what Fiore says are the eight essential elements of the wrestler.
Did we not go over to the first?
No.
Oh, sorry, we're going over that first. Okay. My bad. So, the eight essential things that we need for grappling is strength, speed, knowledge of advantageous grapples, knowledge of breaks, knowledge of locks and binds, knowledge of dislocations, knowledge of throws, and knowledge of strikes and dangerous places.
Okay. Foundational to everything, including grappling, is our footwork. Can you please demonstrate for us the main piece of footwork that we use?
Okay. Firstly, we got the accrescimento, increasing step, where we increase towards our opponent. This is often followed by our back leg doing the same to get back in our stance. We got the decreasing step, where we decrease away from our opponent. Similar thing with increasing step, usually accompanied by the other leg. Then we got three turns. We got the bolt stabile, where we pivot in place, accompanied by a we've got the tooth volta, which is the alternate, where we pivot on one leg, around one leg. Most of these steps could also be done on the traverse. So if we take an increasing step off the as a traversing step as well, we could increase off to the side, off the line.
Okay, and the all of Fiore's main sections are founded on your comfortable step. Can you please show for us and explain the basic grappling?
Okay, most of the grappling. So firstly, we got longa, which is an extended guard here, and we bladed, and did it like this. Next, we got horse tooth here. These two guards, Fiore says, oppose each other. Next, we got frontale over here, arms in front of our face, elbows down. And next, we got iron gate here, our hands on our belts over here. These two guards also.
Okay, can you please combine the posta and footwork together? And that demo.
Okay.
Okay, good. All right, that's it. All right, so now, using your Zubidore, can you please show for us the first six plays of Other's Eye? And demonstrate each play once with an explanation as you see fit, of course, and then a second time without explanation.
Okay. So, he's grabbing here. Thank you. opposition to. So for third play, I'm stepping in here and pushing this way. So which direction you can see what. And then for the first play, second play, I'm throwing in for this front.
Just one of the mechanical aspects that makes the throws working.
Yeah, so the thing we want to do is shearing, right? So pushing one, pulling the other, things like that. Yeah.
Give more specific.
Yeah, there's a number of properties you haven't necessarily done for the fourth play. Particular that makes it work way
better. I have a good idea.
I think what you're talking about.
To him three times and demonstrate it again.
Okay.
And then maybe that will drop the memory.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay.
The fourth play.
Here, on to.
Speaking of striking, what place does striking have in the art broadly, but of the art specifically?
Yeah, striking is a tool we can use to gain more advantageous grapples and other things that are more permanent. Striking gives us opportunities, it gives us the tempo to do something more severe to that. Yeah.
Okay. Any last questions? No? Great. All right, so we'll take last stop. And we're going to do a bit of grappling demonstration. So Bastian, please provide the candidates sufficient impetus, and Kevin, please demonstrate what you know. Okay, again.
the indentation first, which comes, right, Andrea Speck first, which comes at an angle here. Aiming ideally right down the collarbone, but he also says anywhere from the head to elbows. Next is Nente. Very similar idea here. Or you can also move the face. The reverse strike is just like a Mandrio strike, but just on the other side. And Supani is the one that comes from below like this, underneath the bottom of the chest.
Can you go around the clock twice more without comment? Okay, there are four masters that precede the book. Oh, you have a question for this. Why are these the targets of the day?
Because they are
Fair enough. Just to make a non-facetious point there. So what targets would not be dead? Or what targets would you hesitate? Would you prefer striking with the dagger if you had a choice?
I wouldn't necessarily go for the arms. I would like to go into the chest cavity here, get the important organs here.
Now, and that's because in this situation your aim would be too wide.
Okay.
The four masters, you see the dagger section, who are they?
Okay, so first master is the master of disarms. He's shown with a dagger at his belt and also one in his hand, which he presumably had just taken from his opponent. Next is the master of breaks. He's shown with two disembodied arms, representing his being the master of breaks. Next we have the master of keys. He's shown holding a giant pair of keys, or a giant key. And the last one is Master of Throws, who is shown with a victory palm in his hand and a guy at his feet that he's standing over.
Okay, and who cares? Why are they there? What significance do they have to us?
Yeah, well, Fiore tells us that when faced with the dagger, those four things plus striking is what you should be doing. Yeah, great.
Right. Do you have any cockamamie theories about why they're dressed differently?
Yeah.
Nobody gets a chance to give.
Yeah, sure. So some theories are that it is a value judgment on what's better. So maybe the throws are better than the disarms. Another theory is that, you know, the more elaborate they get, the closer they get to their opponent. Because disarms happen at the furthest range and throws happen the closest. So maybe it's a measure of that, yeah, and like how ballsy you need to be to get that close. Yeah.
Or throws are best done with long ears. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Fashion, best throw over time.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So now, please demonstrate the basic defenses against all the attacks.
Okay.
You can do it once with brief commentary as needed and then twice and more around the clock.
So, I'll leave first. I'm going to talk through it. So, when you throw that, I'm going to take an increasing step up the line. I'll block that here, manga, and trap the after. And then complete. Similar, I'm going to take that increasing step, but I'll also move to the ball step so that if this fails, I'll get stabbed. Okay, reverse complete. Increase and then pass here. And as soon as I get that,
making your defense, what are the critical elements that it must have?
I must have the structure behind it to stop the force. I also want my other hand to be out here to either strike or do any follow-on actions.
Great, is there anything else that it needs?
Not that I can think of it.
Okay. Please demonstrate now for us a disarm, a break, a key, and a throw from each of the basic defenses.
Okay. So for the Mandrita disarm, please give me an ear strike and stay. For the Mandrita disarm, same thing.
So with that play, what are you intending to achieve?
Yeah. So once you give me that strike, and I feel that push through, you come under here, and make sure that the elbows point downward off my shoulder, in which I can break that ankle that I hit. Okay. Next, we got the Vimente break. Fiore also showed it with this leg being kicked out, so we might sit on that as well.
Pause people, so you're saying like stay, push through, what is that? Why does it matter?
Yeah, so that determines what next move I should be doing, the optimal move in that situation. If he gives me a Andreas drag and he pulls back, it's hard for me to do this arm because that's not what's available to me. If he stays,
there, what are you intending to achieve? He's wearing nice big fluffy.
Yeah, it's hard to see, but I wanted the elbow to be pointed in this direction so I can come in with my arm here and break it. Okay, moving on to the keys. Please give me an Andrea strike with a bent arm, please, and stay there. From here. Fendente key. You can give me a Fendente. dislocate his arm or throw him to the ground.
Sure.
Reverse your strike, please, and pull back. And when you pull back, do it a little towards the downwards. Similar thing, I'll either dislocate him or throw him to the ground. Now please give me a platonic strike and pull back. You do that same move here.
Okay, for the those keys and you're instructing the word to pull back, is there anything that you're doing allowing you to fall?
Yes. So when I get this defense, I'm gonna make sure to trap so that when he pulls back, I feel it. And I'm able to follow in and do my play. Move on to throws. Please give me
a push.
Oh, good. There.
So you showed a lower key. There are two of them. What's the next one?
So the other one is a weak lower key. So if you give me a yes, Tani, and push, pull back. I'm going to go with this arm instead and go here to that weak low key. From here, I can condition or whatever.
Why not? Why is it weak?
Yeah. Why is it weak? Because it doesn't put as much force on him. He's able to do this step a little bit easier. So from here, I might want to switch over to that strong one. Back, move off the side of the straight arm. Here, throw in this way.
Oh, let me not finish that one.
Yeah.
Come on, you finished it on me.
For this one, please stay. This is that third play of wrestling right there. One more time.
Can you finish that one? Sorry, I got a
dent. From here, I'm going to grab that and pull up. And if the leg comes up, I'll grab it as well. One more time?
One more time.
All right.
Thank you. Yeah, all right. So, so in this portion, Fiore is going to give you a basic feed of random attacks, and you're going to, as in the wrestling portion, show us what you know. Best you can. Okay?
I'm
waiting for you.
I'm good.
Great. All right. That's the sword. Please tell us about it.
Yes, it's a long sword. We got probably the blade and the hilt. Here we got the tip and two edges. One of them is a true edge and one of them is a false edge. The true edge corresponds with where your knuckles are. And the other one's a false edge. We divide the blade into three sections. The weak, middle and strong. The blade also continues through the hilt in the form of a tang. Moving on to hilt now, we got the guard here, cross guard, left grip, and left pommel. Some other properties of the sword is the point of balance, which is here, which is important because that's what we want to be moving when we cut, and also that's where the sword revolves around. Next is the center of percussion, right over here, as well as right here, the right arm here, right hand. These are the most efficient places to strike with if we want maximum impact.
Okay, which part of the sword is a weapon?
Any part of the sword can use a weapon.
Okay. So, as we've been doing, please begin this portion of the task by demonstrating to us all of the four styles.
Okay.
In one hand and in two.
Okay. Well, sort of one hand card, but I'll go through everything.
Yeah.
Okay. So we got left forward in this case. We got both of the Anestra on the other side. This is Adana. We got Longa, Frontale, Frontale, Breve, and Breve. That's for Longa. And with two hands, I'll do the English this time. We got left tail, fourth tooth, middle iron gate, feet, middle iron gate, full iron gate, right tail. We got guard of the woman, window guard, two horn guard, window guard, woman guard, long guard, we got front guard, and short guard.
Can you go through them both again without commentary and facing that way?
Okay.
Using Alex as a target, can you please show us all of the attacks of the sword?
Okay. First we got the Ventrino Pendente. This one goes from teeth to knees, so almost vertical. This. That's a little longer. We need to scoop. We got on that same side, Mitani, which goes target the head to knee. Is on this side. We got Sultani, which comes up this on that same line as Mente. On the other side goes it up. The reverse Sultani here. And the reverse Sultani, which uses the false head. And also the reverse Mente. Last but not least, we got the thrust.
Please show all the thrusts in there.
Okay. We can categorize them in different hand positions. We got thrust in first, thrust in second, thrust in third, thrust in third, as well as another third.
Okay, do it all again. Before you're gonna make some basic attack defenses in a moment. Before we do that, can you please describe for us the blade engagements, possible blade engagements of the sword?
Okay. So the first one is an oblique engagement. I want my sword to be engaged here at an angle so that I can slide. Next one is the bind, so turn your edge in, please, where we bind together, the edges bite in, where everything stops, and we're able to do something afterwards. Next we got the beat, you turn your flat against mine, my edge, that allows us to displace our opponent's plate like this. And next one, please defend this thrust in breve. We're going to do a underneath. That is an example of a void engagement where I refuse that bind on the ground.
Okay. Question. Which ones are the lowest in the
there another type of deflection other than the true edge deflection?
Sure, at least off edge. If you give me a cut, meant to cut, I could beat it away with my false edge.
When we, in the next portion, please do all the false edge defenses, you know, in the as you proceed.
Okay.
Well, that's fine for now. Okay. If it doesn't later, please ask.
In terms of the void, is there another way that you can void perhaps more simply without even using the blade?
Yeah, sure. I showed that because the blade is with, but yes, if you do my body to my leg here, I'm able to void that cut, attack at the same time. That's one of the larger plates.
Okay, so now, please go around the clock. Alex, give him around the clock tasks. You're going to defend twice around with the sword in one hand and then the sword in two.
Okay.
Okay. Oh, stop. I'm sorry. I should have asked you to mask up. Mask up. That way you can finish.
Okay, one more time around, but answer me this question first. When you're, we talk about fighting with a sword in kind of two distance groups. What are they?
Largo and Strato.
Okay, what is Largo?
Largo is the loose, long plate, the unconstrained plate, and the Strato is close plate, constrained plate. Where there's a lot more grappling happening.
Okay. If you're intending to perform largo actions, is there a particular place on the sword that you're intending to defend?
Yes. For largo actions, most of them want to be major and tips, compared to strato actions where we want to get the middle.
Okay. Please go around the clock again with the sword in one hand and keep that in mind. Okay, so with the defenses you're trying to do against Sultana blows, what are you intending to achieve?
So, trying to get back, get my hands out of the, get my hands out of the way, engage the blade, and then exchange the thrust.
Okay. Can you show it to us as perfect as you can manufacture it? Give it all that helps, whatever instructions you need.
Yeah. So if you go slowly and give me a Sultana to my hands, or to where my hands would be, and I'm going to fade back here, engage that blade, and thrust afterwards.
Okay, again. And with the defense against thrusts, what are you intending to achieve?
Very similar. You give me a thrust. I'm going to take an off traversing step off the line, get my angle, engage up the tips, and thrust through.
Okay, one more time. So, moving on, as you said just previous, Fiore talks about Jacques Largo and Jacques Stiletto, okay? Please demonstrate for us the plays of Jacques Largo.
Okay, may I take this off?
Yes, you can actually, thank you, yeah. You can keep his honor off, Alex, as you see.
Moving on to the next place, we're just going to go from the engagement. So, the next play is going to be a blade grab. I need this blade to be in presence. From here, I'm going to grab that blade and cut the head. For the next one, I'm actually going to do a little closer. I'm going to do that blade grab. I'm going to kick it in the knee.
What's a peasant strike?
A peasant strike is a very overcommitted strike.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah. So with a sword, I also said with the axe.
You're
welcome to murder.
Please proceed. What would you know about peasants?
wait. The hand is right there, but I don't want to hit it.
That defense is in the book.
Next. come up under the beard. Now if I do that again, and this blade ends up close to my teeth, I could step on it first, and then come up.
Question, could you step on it if it was in the air?
No, I could not.
So what would, how would it work? Or how would need to work?
So ideally, when I get that break of thrust, if you press that knee, I want this down here, hopefully embedded in the ground, so that I can have time to step on it here. Yeah. Now, if it's far away, I won't be able to do this way, and I'll have to just cut that. Okay, next, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to break the point, I'm going to come up. But this time, please avoid that and follow me up.
Does Fiore give us any advice about how to deal with attacks below the waist?
Thank you. Yes, I did show it earlier, but give me a body here. I'm going to avoid that and cut the head.
It's true. Okay. Defend that in frontale, like if you defended the next one, it would be.
I was asking.
Okay.
That's a good question.
It's not a wrong thing to defend. So if he doesn't see your second one coming, let's put it that
okay.
way. My
that again. And I strike him enough, or he gets tired, or he charges me up and puts that sword down. I'm able to pass this and get this position. Okay. Next we have one where I need an opening on my lower right quadrant here. So we cross over here. Slap that away. Come on, across. One more time. Okay. The next one I'll show is the same thing really as the dagger disarm, where I come up under here. And I disarm this way, which opens me up. I can also do this deeper in and go for a middle two. Right, one more time. So that can also be countered. So if you do that against me. I can get in here in the lower key. I can also do it late inverted. If I can get that on the grid, and close this. I will now, there's one more that I want to show before this arms. This comes from a blade gap here after you defend this. So I go with that. Fiore showed it as a you actually take the bolt stab right away. If it looks like, I can come in here and stab. In the next play, you also talk about and getting this over top of his head, but since he's taller, I'm going to go here. like this. You should have played this. Now we've got disarms. So across the middle here. I have an opening up the left. I'm going to make my arm across here. And do this this time. While holding on here. One more time. Okay. Next is the middle. Middle this arm, I'll hide this arm, middle this arm, where I need this available to you. Going to do it. One more time, please. Okay. Next, low this arm, we're going to need that palm complete. Same kind of principle. Last but not least, talking about quality play in this third section, is if this blade is available to me here, I'm going to grab it with my right arm, drop my sword, disarm it, and do stuff. Do terrible stuff. That's all I know about the third section.
Anybody have any final questions about anything sword related? Alright, so that concludes the demonstration portion of the test. Please prepare yourself for fencing. And so all scholars, let's say, three, four minutes, get yourself ready to fence, okay? And then arrange yourself in order of latest scholar test to last, starting on this side. So latest scholar test, Graham, that's a good thing. And then starting over here. Okay, go. Make sure
sure you have steel. If you don't have steel, steel will be provided to you.
I promised I'd tell my parents when we were about an hour out from being done. I don't see anyone better.
Camera's still on.
Thank you. part of the color test, remember the goddamn word of corruption.
Yeah.
I think I'm after.
It's very, very close, like you need a balance against you. So as long as you need like 3, 4, 1, 2, right?
Yeah, no, I think Duncan was, I think, the test.
Right.
We had to figure this out last time.
Yeah, I was.
Thank you.
Good. Good. Thank you, Graham. We're not. Again. Good. Duncan. Again. Stop! Okay, take a minute, breather, get some water, Kevin, get some water.
Where's your dagger?
Thank you, Alex.
Oh. Oh, no.
Yeah, you can have a bad person.
am I getting? Your reputation precedes you.
He's actually really nice.
Aaron Beatty!
Let him give you a big hug.
Begin. Okay, a quick 1 minute break there, Kevin. And then you're last one.
Roll your hit dice.
Okay, last caller. Baby Vito. Again.
With the ring guards? Come on.
This is the least of the problems, Kevin.
Yes.
Okay. The judge portion of the fencing test. Now the assembled free scholars get to fence you as long as they want.
So you get triple, right?
For our
final boss.
For our
final boss.
Okay, let's go.
Roll those hit dice, Kevin. Then you know.
Just keep moving. Ready?
Pretty good. Yeah. Let's see. Because, like, that was just...
Oh, I thought you said hello.
I knew he was planning something, but it's okay.
Maybe.
toss. Like, actually, it hit him. It hit him in the face.
That was great.
Aaron, you want me to turn this off?